Okay, this we've looked at this before. We need to be exceedingly glad when all this is happening. We need to be happy that we're sharing our faith and we're letting our light shine. Okay, let's start looking at what we must become. In a view given, this is early writings, in a view given June 27, 1850, my accompanying angel said, "Time is almost finished. Do you reflect the lovely image of Jesus as you should?" Said the angel, "Get ready, get ready." Now obviously, this is an important message because the angel is saying this. And the angel is asking, do we reflect the image of Christ? We can see already in what we've looked at already, the early Christians and others, that they and we should be reflecting Jesus maybe in ways that we haven't thought of before. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Ye will have to die a greater death to the world than ye have ever yet died. I saw that there was a great work to do for them, and but little time in which to do it. Then I saw the seven last plagues were soon to be poured out upon those who have no shelter. Of course, the atonement process, the atonement means to cover, so whoever these people are, they didn't get ready. They did not approach the throne of grace. And so they have not been atoned for. They do not have the righteousness of Christ upon them. So they're naked. Okay, I put these two together. I'm looking at John 5:19 and early writing 71. And there's a good relationship to these two. Let's look at John 5:19 first. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner." So we can see that the Son reflects the Father. Everything that the Father does, the Son copies. So he's reflecting his Father. We can also see that we must be doing the same thing in reference to Christ. The orange lettering at the very bottom, we must reflect the image of Jesus fully. We need to be doing the same thing that Jesus is doing of his Father. Let's read the whole thing. "I also saw that many do not realize what they must be in order to live in the sight of the Lord without a high priest in the sanctuary through the time of trouble. Those who receive the seal of God, of the living God, and are protected in the time of trouble must reflect the image of Jesus fully." And I think this is very important here. Many of us do not realize what we must become. Now here's another comparison between John 5:19 to, I'm looking at verse 24, and early writings, page 71. "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. So the righteous will have everlasting life and he will not be judged. He will not have the plagues falling on him. And after the 1,000 years, they will not face the judgment of the wicked." Now let's look at early writings. I saw that many were neglecting the preparation so needful and were looking to the time of refreshing and latter rain. You know, many of us, you know, at times I've thought that, you know, I just need a little bit more, I need a reason to come to God. And isn't that ridiculous? We need a reason to come to Christ when He's done so much for us. It's as if I'm waiting for the emotion to happen before I do the things that provide me that help. I'm backwards. We need to receive, we need to go and get that help from God. The refreshing, the latter rain, that's at the very end. We need to be prepared before that time. I saw that many were neglecting the preparation so needful, and were looking to the time of refreshing and the latter rain to fit them to stand in the day of the Lord and to live in His sight. Oh, how many I saw in the time of trouble without a shelter. This is, you know, the covering again. If we have that covering, we will not come into judgment. We must be covered. We must come to the throne of grace. Now, all this to me is overwhelming. How can we do these things? You know, we need to be perfect. How is that possible? Oh, maybe I'm a little ahead of myself. Let's just read. We must no longer remain upon the enchanted ground. We are fast approaching the close of our probation. Let every soul inquire, how do I stand before God? We know not how soon our names may be taken into the lips of Christ and our cases be finally decided. What, oh what, will these decisions be? Shall we be counted with the righteous, or shall we be numbered with the wicked? So this is, obviously, this is an important question we need to ask ourselves. And like I was just saying, sometimes I look at these things and I'm almost overwhelmed. I guess as if I was having to try to do these things myself. But we have a secret weapon. And I've heard a lot about that so far the last couple days. In Desire of Ages. As yet the disciples were unacquainted with the Savior's unlimited resources and power. This is our secret weapon. What is it? He said to them, hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. He explained that the secret of their success would be in asking for strength and grace in His name. This reminds me of Hebrews 4:16, and we're familiar with this. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So this is the sanctuary service that we're talking about. This is our secret weapon. He would be present before the Father to make requests for them. And now we're in the most holy place. Going on. The prayer of the humble suppliant he presents as his own desire in that soul's behalf. Every sincere prayer is heard in heaven. You know, we have an audience with the Most High through Jesus. And this is our secret weapon. This is our Savior's unlimited resources and power. And if we're not utilizing these things, if we do not utilize our high priest, the service that he provides for us, we won't have any chance at all. Every soul has the privilege of stating to the Lord his own special necessities, and to offer his individual thanksgiving for the blessings that he daily receives. Skipping down to the orange, we need, oh, so much, clean, converted hearts. We need to have our faith strengthened. Down to the red text, we need to take hold of Christ and to retain our hold of him until we know that the power of his transforming grace is manifested in us. We must have faith in Christ if we would reflect the divine character. Each one of us has a privilege of coming to the Lord. Okay, this is something that hit me between the eyes. Christ does not bid his followers strive to shine. Have you ever tried to let your light shine? Okay, let me read it right. Christ does not bid his followers strive to shine. He says, let your light shine. If you have received the grace of God, the light is in you. Remove the obstructions, and the Lord's glory will be revealed. What kind of obstructions do we have? It means taking away our sins, down to the blue text. It means a heart emptied of self and blessed with the abiding presence of Christ. When Christ reigns in the soul, there is purity, freedom from sin. These are the kinds of things that remove the obstructions of the help that we so dearly need. Okay, I'm going to skip one here, and it's slide 22. Let's look at Ezekiel 9:5, because in Ezekiel, there's an important aspect to Christ's character that is hidden in these verses, and we need to look at this. Ezekiel 9:5, we're very familiar with this. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark on the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And what does that tell us about the righteous? Mrs. White comments in Third Testimonies. Mark this point with care. Those who receive the pure mark of truth wrought by them by the power of the Holy Ghost, represented by a mark by the man in linen, are those that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the church. Okay, here's what I'm looking for. This is the gold. This explains their actions, their love for purity, and the honor and glory of God is such that they have so clear a view of the exceeding sinfulness of sin that they are represented as being in agony. It's tearing their heart up because of what they're seeing, because they love God so much. Yes?
Actually, the verse that you read was Ezekiel 9:4.
9:4? Oh, I have it right in my notes and wrong there. I'm sorry.
Okay.
You're right. It's Ezekiel 9:4. But look at the wicked. Look at the other group. But the general slaughter of all those who do not thus see the wide contrast between sin and righteousness. See, the righteous see the awfulness of sin. They see the righteousness of Christ. And they see they're God's own people. And they are sighing and crying for all this. Maranatha, 2:40. The class who do not feel grieved over their own spiritual declension, nor mourn over the sins of others, would be left without the seal of God. So we're looking at a characteristic of the righteous people. We're looking at the character of Christ in these people. As you can read, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you can see the same torture that Jesus went through. Now, what about our church or Christians? Among professing Christians of today, there is a fearful lack of the sympathy that should be felt for souls unsaved. What about the people around us? We have this great truth. What about our neighbor? Unless our hearts beat in unison with the heart of Christ, how can we understand the sacredness and importance of the work which we are called by the words, watch for souls, as they must give account? Obviously, the command of Christ. Intense earnestness, this is 9T44. Intense earnestness should now take possession of us. Now, skipping down to the red text. My brother, my sister, is it nothing to you to know that every day souls are going down into the grave unwarned and unsaved, ignorant of their need of eternal life and of the atonement made for them by the Savior?
Amen.
Now, I can remember growing up, sometimes I did some things I knew I shouldn't have done, and it was really bad. And my mother would say something like, how could you do this thing? I mean, it's there is something missing in me. I just totally missed the boat. I am devoid of humanity, you know, for doing this thing. And my mother, when she's telling me this, you know, how could you do this? It's just the same feeling I get here. Do you get the feeling? Let's read this over again. I get the feeling that, you know, the people that she's talking to, that there's something sadly lacking here. My brother, my sister, is it nothing to you to know that every day souls are going down into the grave unwarned and unsaved, ignorant of their need of eternal life and of the atonement made for them by the Savior? Is it nothing to you that soon the world is to meet Jehovah over his broken law? Heavenly angels marvel that those who for so many years have had the light, have not carried the torch of truth into the dark places of the earth. So here we are, we have this truth. What are we doing about it? Is there something missing in us? Are we lacking something? General Conference Bulletin, May 17, 1909, paragraph 15. As soon as Christ becomes an abiding presence in the heart, We shall not be able to see souls perishing in ignorance of the truth. We won't be able to bear it. You know, sometimes you can read Mrs. White's experience, and she just bowls over. She hardly can take the idea that somebody won't accept. You know, when she gives out a message, are they going to accept it, or are they going to ignore it? And the heartache she went through. This will be the experience of the righteous. And the people around us, as we see, are they going to be rejecting? Are we even going to them? Do we have this abiding presence of the heart? Do we have the character of Christ? Is Christ molding our operation, our desires? As soon as Christ becomes an abiding presence in the heart, we shall not be able to see souls perishing in ignorance of the truth and be at rest. We will make any sacrifice that we will make any sacrifice that we may reach them. Are we making any sacrifice in our life today to reach the people around us, to reach the people of the world? We need to overcome all kinds of things. Do we have a passion for the people who are not overcoming? General Conference Bulletin, May 17, 1909, paragraph 20. To abide in Christ means that you shall be a partaker of the divine nature. Humanity lays hold upon divinity, and you have divine power. But, listen, look at this green text. But if you cling to old habits and practices of self-indulgence, thinking about yourself, and refuse to carry the burden of souls, you will lose your own soul. Down to the red text and in the middle. It is the privilege of every believer to purify his soul. Now the last. Oh, that this burden might be rolled upon souls, and that they might realize that if they will be overcomers, they can help others to overcome. Okay, this text really amazed me. Many of the barren, unworked fields must be entered by beginners. Have you ever read that? You know, we're all beginners. Almost. Mrs. White was talking to, sorry I don't have this, it's somebody's experience with Mrs. White. And she was, you know, she saw a need and she started working on the project, but she didn't know how to do it, but she was doing it anyway. And Mrs. White was talking to her and she put her hand on her shoulder and says, you know, as a Christian, we all find ourselves doing things we don't know how to do. And then she said, I've been doing that all my life, doing things that we don't know how to do. When we see a need, are we responding to these needs and doing it? Even if we don't know how to do it, when we see that it has to be done. So, do we have Christ's character of love in us? Are we concerned with self-preservation? This is something I have struggled with, maybe still do? Or are we truly going to truly reflect Christ, to long for souls to be saved? When we love purity and the honor and glory of God, I guess I didn't finish that one, but do we have God's honor in our heart? Do we know the difference and the awfulness of sin and righteousness? Will we be able to make any sacrifice to reach the unsaved? That's, and you know, as you read great controversy in these last moments of the earth, it's what we find the righteous doing. What, oh what, will Christ's decision be made concerning us and the judgment in the most holy place? By the way, this address down here is on my website, www.mhrc.net/campmeeting. If you go there within a few days, you'll have my slide project slides, and you also have my notes as well.